birthday, buddy.
Miss Tisdale?
Yes.
What happened to your birthday?
Can we share a little bit?
My daughter's the first thing in my
head. Hello, sir.
How you doing?
Yeah, how
you
doing?
Happy birthday.
You have observers?
Oh, well, I'm going to be all the... That's what I'm talking today.
Good.
Thursday, Grant. I'm Hal Snyder, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we're watching you on the...
It's all right. I can take care of it. It's all good.
5:01 p.m. If you'll please stand if you can for the invocation of the pledge. Dear Heavenly Father, please look down upon all of us and offer your guiding hand and protection. Help us to make the best decisions possible for the citizens of Forsyth County. And please look after those who put themselves in harm's way for ourselves, both overseas and here at home. In thy holy name we pray.
Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Ken, is now the time to do the consent agenda thing or during consent agenda?
Now is the time, Mr. Chairman. If you want me to do it or you want to do it, or
if you'll do it.
I've got a few members of the board, if you can just bear with me for a second. And they do, two of them pertain to the consent agenda. Number one is consent agenda item number 3, which is an approval of a right-of-way easement between the Forsyth County and Sony Electric membership. We have two of those that are currently in the works right now. This one's on consent. There's some language that my office continues to have some concerns with. I would ask that this be placed on the new business agenda, that the rules require a motion and second, and then it will come off consent and go to new. And I will tell you, when it gets to new business, when we get there, I'm just going to ask that you postpone it until a date certain. But that's the way the procedure we have to get there.
Can you do that?
So moved.
Second.
That's all it takes, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Okay. And that'll be new agenda item, new business agenda item number 4. Mr. Chairman, there's no vote. There's no vote needed. It's a motion to second. Just to remove something off the consent agenda to the party. Mr. Chairman, the next item I would like to have moved to the new business agenda would be consent agenda item number 6, which is the agreement amendment with Advanced Ambulance Service. I want to just bring to your attention an issue with respect to some corporate formality, but I'll bring that to you if it's on new business. I'll bring that to you at that time. And I'll take a motion and a second, Mr. Chairman.
So moved.
Second. Okay, Ken, you good to go with that one?
That makes it.
That's it. That's all. That's been done. I've got one more.
New five,
yes. Mr. Chairman, the next issue, and I want the whole board to hear me on this one. There was some instruction that we were to bring back the issue of Nancy Reagan Drive with respect to Taubman and Farrelson, and the issue of whether or not they have worked out an easement. I don't know if the board is ready to hear that this evening or not, but I did get some instruction to bring it back to this meeting, and I don't want to skip this meeting without having raised it to you, but it's not on your agenda.
Yes, sir. If the board's so inclined, I have heard from those parties, and they're continuing to work through to actually make progress. I'd like to ask if we move to the first meeting.
we could do a motion and second and take a vote. I know that's a little unusual because we're adopting the agenda, but if we could do that, that would be appropriate.
That motion? Second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Not, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by pressing the button. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Passed unanimously. The next issue that I wanted to bring to you with respect to the agenda pertained to the last work session when we were discussing the procedures regarding an intergovernmental agreement. And what the rules provide is that in the event that an intergovernmental agreement does not receive a 4/5, that a simple majority can place the item on the next public hearing agenda, which I believe caused the board a little bit of concern because that's in April. The only way to reduce that timeline would be to literally change your rules, which you can do with a 4/5 vote. So I'm bringing this to you based upon some feedback I've heard. Does the board want to add as a time-sensitive item on new business modification of the board's internal rules of procedure? I'm throwing it out there to you, but it's up to you whether or not you want to pursue that.
In the work session, it was very strong discussed by everybody there, even if I put my proposal on the table, that you weren't interested in the proposal at the time because we didn't have enough time to get it done. This gives you the opportunity to get it done. In some way, it's kind of calling it bluff, though. If you don't want it, then obviously you won't have to do the timeline to begin with. You just want to set it.
You want the public hearing anyway. Don't bluff it. I don't want you to
It will be an earlier public hearing, which gives you more time to work on it and get it done in time before it expires.
Maybe this is my fault. I didn't explain what I understood there was an interest in doing. What I understood there was an interest in doing was changing the rule so that it could go not to the next public hearing agenda, of which we have one a month, but to the next agenda on which a public hearing could be called, which we could do that anytime. We could call one, for instance, the second meeting in March. You see, that I was trying to help you if you wanted to bump it back a few days. Not seeing groundswell of support for that. So, thank you. One further item, Mr. Chairman, and again, forgive me for being so long-winded. The county has received several different inquiries regarding some language in our alcohol code, particularly with respect to disqualifying events. Right now, we have language in the code that will basically prohibit even a server's license if there has ever been a prior conviction for what's called moral turpitude. This particular individual had a bad check some years ago. There is case law that suggests that is a crime of moral turpitude, and I think there has been some interest in perhaps revisiting the code with respect to that particular disqualifying event. Would the board like to add the time-sensitive item on new business discussion of alcohol code related to that issue?
I will.
I'll take a 4/5, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously.
That's all I have.
If that's added to new business, Ken?
Yes.
You may just number 6.
Are there any other changes? Are there any other changes to the agenda?
So, Mr. Chairman, the Department of Planning and Community Development request public hearing number 7, the request by Ethan Underwood on behalf of MKM Homes. This involves a stream buffer variance, and the engineering department notified me this afternoon. There are some outstanding calculations in regards to the buffer mitigation plan, and the engineering department cannot at this time issue you the technical guidance letter that is required under our ordinance. So I would request that you consider postponing this item.
So we need
2 weeks?
Yep.
Yes, I'd say 2 weeks, next meeting, and then if it's not straightened out by that time, I'll request another postponement.
March 15th? So
yes.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. To move that item number 7 to March 15th. Any other changes to the agenda? Chair entertains a motion to adopt the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item. And that passes unanimously. Announcements and reports. Commissioner Tam, I don't know if anyone told you that your person of interest is here.
Talk about now?
If you would like to look.
Sure. I just wanted to point out, we also have another requisition on there for an internal department.
Why don't you go ahead?
Okay, thank you. Is Brandon Woodlatch in the house? Yes, sir. How are you?
Here, yes.
Thank you for coming in this evening. Would you care to come down here to the podium? A resolution by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, to Brandon Whitlatch, his fellow scouts, scoutmaster, and all the leaders of Troop 2000 in the Atlanta Area Council of the Boy Scouts of America, and to all persons to whom these presents shall come, greetings. Whereas Brandon Whitlatch is a resident of Forsyth County, a graduate of Lambert High School, and a student at North Georgia College and State University. And whereas, in conformity with the requirements to attain the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America as determined by an Eagle Scout Board of Review, Brandon Whitlatch has been found worthy of promotion to the rank of Eagle Scout. And whereas, in honor of this achievement, an Eagle Scout Court of Honor was held on February 18, 2012 to officially bestow upon Brandon Whitlatch the rank of Eagle Scout. And whereas Brandon Whitlatch is a dedicated young man who has earned the respect and admiration of his fellow scouts throughout his active participation in the many programs sponsored by the Boy Scouts of America, now therefore be it and it is hereby resolved that the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, in recognition of the honor bestowed on Brandon Whitlatch, does hereby express its pride in his earning the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America, and best wishes for the future. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be recorded in the official minute book of the Board of Commissioners, and that a copy of same be presented to Brandon Whitlatch. In testimony whereof, we have hereunto affixed the seal of the County of Forsyth, State of Georgia, and signatures of the members of the governing body thereof, given at Cumming, Georgia, on this first day of March, 2012. Congratulations, Brandon.
Congratulations.
Sir, congratulations, too.
And in recognition of the Forsyth County Finance Department for being awarded the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting, I would first like if David Groen and everyone else from, anyone else who's here from finance to please just come down and stand at the podium if you will, please. On behalf of the Board of Commissioners, I'd like to extend congratulations to the Forsyth County Finance Department. For the 11th consecutive year, Forsyth County has been awarded the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting by the Government Finance Officers Association of the United States and Canada. This recognition was presented to Forsyth County for its comprehensive annual financial report issued for fiscal year 2010. The Certificate of Achievement is the highest form of recognition in the area of governmental accounting and financial reporting. An award of financial reporting achievement was also awarded to Finance Director slash CFO David Groen as the individual primarily responsible for preparing the award-winning 2010 financial report. Congratulations to Mr. Groen and the Finance Department of Forsyth County for this achievement, and thank you for your hard work and your commitment to transparency in the county's financial operations. And personally, thank you, Dave. Do you have anything you want to say?
Just thank you on behalf of the entire finance department, because really this is an award that the entire office puts a lot of hours into. I just get the privilege of helping to lead that effort this past year.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we come to the public comments portion of our program.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outburst applause or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or a public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. We have 4 public comment speakers this evening. Our first speaker is Brent Meadows.
Schedule has been cleared to a certain degree. I hope that you will have some time to devote to ethics, and particularly the dilemma of the Forsyth County Board of Ethics. Now is a good time to consider corrective action. I personally have experience with the Board of Ethics and have also served on two county boards. Currently, the Board of Ethics is before the courts to resolve a dilemma with the Board of Ethics rules. The state of Georgia is embarking on an overhaul of sunshine laws, and I'm hopeful that you will consider overhauling the Forsyth County ethics rules. As you are aware, many rule changes have already taken place, but these changes have only been a band-aid approach. Please consider the following should you choose to embark on an overhaul. First, the board makeup. Currently, the board is made up of fellow Forsyth County residents. Inevitably, the board seems to get mired in politics. Possibly consider a board comprised of attorneys from the indigent defense pool of another county to avoid politics. They are currently having concerns about political participation by ethic board members. Two current board members of the Board of Ethics have liked politicians on their Facebook page. This is a violation of ethics rules. Other political involvement appears to have occurred also, which leads me to my next suggestion. Education, training, and testing of ethics board members and staff. Without training and testing, we can expect others to fall victim to the board that, simply put, doesn't know their own rules. Finally, please consider establishing a committee of stakeholders to recommend to you revisions and corrective action up to and including the elimination of the Board of Ethics. The Forsyth County Board of Ethics should set the example for all other boards, and they should not be the poster child of how to do it wrong. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Hal Schneider.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Hal Schneider. I am a resident of Forsyth County, and I'm here representing myself individually, although I like to think that I'm representing a silent majority of the county residents who are also customers of the Forsyth County Water Department. I am here to speak in opposition of the extension of the current water contract through October as proposed in Tuesday's work session. The current contract forces the county to purchase 4.5 million gallons of finished water from the city that on a normal day the county doesn't even need. The annual cost of this forced purchase is nearly $4 million. Extending the existing contract until October would cost the county residents about $200,000 per month, or a total of $1 million over what it would cost if Commissioner Levent's proposal were implemented. The argument is made that we must work on the water contract in conjunction with the service delivery strategy and loss negotiations because they are interdependent. I'm sorry, but that argument just doesn't hold water. Pun intended. First of all, getting the water contract in place before it expires completes that small piece of the service delivery strategy early, letting the board concentrate on other issues. Secondly, the water contract should not play any role in the loss list because the water rates already pay for the water services provided by the city. Including them in the loss split would be paying the city twice for the same services. The other argument that I've heard is that if we allow the contract to expire and the mayor raises the rates, how would the commissioners be able to explain to the county residents why water rates went up, which they might? That's really simple. Blame the mayor. He raised the rates. He'll be the one responsible. It's also been suggested that he could raise the raw water rate to make up the loss. He'd have to raise it from 10 cents per thousand gallons to $1 per thousand gallons to make up the reduction. It would be interesting to hear the mayor explain that increase to a judge. Letting the contract expire means the county would no longer be obligated to purchase any water that it doesn't need. While Commissioner Levent's proposal goes a long way to get the county to the position it needs to be in, I do not agree with paying one dime of the city to the city for the $11 million bill that was sent in January at the behest of one of the commissioners here today. It is my understanding that the county attorney has already sent a letter to the mayor telling him that the county's position is that the county is not liable for the charges included in that bill. The city has been fleecing the county residents for the past 25 years to the tune of $12 million last year for excessive water charges, excessive loss, and loss splits. It is no wonder that the city has no debt and had $27 million in reserves at the end of 2010. They were able to pay the $17 million cost of the upgrade to their intake because they had been banking their excess profits from the county residents for years and had the cash on hand. The only reason that I can come up with, can I have one more minute, please?
That exception.
The only reason I can come up with for extending the existing contract is so that certain commissioners on this board will not have to be held accountable to the voters in July when they vote in favor of a contract that is good for the city and bad for the county. Extension is nothing but a political ploy to allow some commissioners to vote in favor of the city after the July elections without consequence. How about doing what is best for the county residents for a change? It is way past time for the county commissioners to stop allowing the tail to wag the dog. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Alexandria Levent.
Consent agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item. And that passes unanimously. Public hearings. First one is for BL Business, Dan.
This public hearing number one, this is application AL120555, located in Commission District Number 3, and is a request for approval of an alcohol license for BL Business, Inc., doing business as Health Food Mart. Name licensee is Suda R. Patel. For an application to sell malt beverages in line by the package at the place of business located at 6700 Atlanta Highway. All the information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. We vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of this license? Is there anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to it? Chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the issue. And that passes unanimously.
Just double check, Mr. Ryan. I'm looking at the records and everything looks like everything's approved and the recommendations are to approve this. Is that correct?
That's correct.
I make a motion that we approve the request for alcohol license to sell beverage malt liquor and wine by the package of VL Business Inc. DBA Alpha Food Mart named license as Debs R. Patel, AL120555.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion about the motion? If not, please vote on the issue. And that passes unanimously. We're now at a second reading of proposed amendment for Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have in front of you this evening a second public hearing with respect to proposed modifications to Forsyth County Ordinance Number 77, Forsyth County Ethics Code. This pertains to technical requirements of the ordinance, particularly with respect to how both special and regular meetings are set. You'll see in your agenda packet on page one that currently a regular meeting has to occur on the second Tuesday in the month of May and November. We have attempted to further distill that such that there is no specific day, but the regular meetings must occur on May and November on dates and times to be set and called by the chairperson of the Board of Ethics, again, to provide greater flexibility on scheduling for this board. The next page of your agenda packet basically accomplishes the same thing with respect to special meetings, which may be called in the dates and times the same set by majority vote of the board or by call of the chairperson. Once again, give greater flexibility for the Board of Ethics to be able to call both regular and special meetings when they can otherwise get a quorum together. Mr. Chairman, this is a second reading of this ordinance this evening. The board may adopt.
Thank you, Council. Chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Is there anyone here this evening wishing to speak in favor of this amendment? Anyone here wishing to speak in opposition? Hearing none, do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Tonight we can adopt this if we wish, Tim.
You can, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion we adopt the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance 77-B regarding meeting procedures presented by a county attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item three is a second reading of an amendment to Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance as well.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have before you this evening a second modification of the proposed ethics ordinance pertaining to conflicts of interest transaction. There should be two pages in your agenda packet that contain the proposed modifications. This was a matter where the board authorized me on January 24th to commence legal ads based upon concerns raised with respect to some of the language. If you look on section 1A of your agenda packet, you will see this language: no official or employee shall acquire or maintain an interest in the contract or transaction if a reasonable basis exists that such an interest would be affected directly by his official act or action. That language in an ethics ordinance is appropriate because what it suggests is that the official, if their interest is affected by a contract, therefore they have an ethical and legal impediment to acting. Therefore, it certainly reads an ethical conflict into the code. It's a clear statement of intent that the ethical propriety of the official's action is at center of stage. If you go to page 2, the current language provides in 2B, make sure I said that right, in section 1B, forgive me, on page 2 of your packet, it contains a per se prohibition, or what I would call a bright line rule. The county shall not enter into any contract involving services or property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, period. There is no concern given with respect to the ethical considerations of whether the employee or official has in fact an ethical conflict. As stated before, it is simply a bright line rule. It takes the ethical question out of the equation, and that was the concern expressed to me, and that was the basis upon which these modifications were proposed. What I have placed in front of you is a modification that would allow the county to enter into a contract with an entity for which has an official or employee as part of that entity, so long as the following things were accomplished. First of all, if the official or employee is obligated or authorized to take an official act, as you do when you vote on contracts, there would be no entitlement for the county to enter into a contract in that situation. However, if the employee or official had no obligation to take official action, the county could enter that sort of contract in the following situations. First of all, the official or employee must have no obligation to take official action. Number two, the contract must be awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the official or employee having the interest must notify procurement staff of the interest. Number four, they must certify that they have not used their influence with the county to achieve any sort of favoritism or advantage with respect to the procurement process, and the contract must otherwise not be prohibited by law. Again, the concern that has been, or that was expressed to me by board members, was that there may be contracts that the county does in fact wish to either remain in or enter into with entities that have an official or employee of the county involved in that entity, but they can't because of this bright line rule. That's what I'm bringing for you this evening. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. What's the pleasure of the board? Oh, actually, I'm sorry. Yeah. Chair, entertains a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion, which carries unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this amendment? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this? Does the chair hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we postpone the decision on this 2 weeks to the March 15th meeting.
Have a motion. I will second for discussion if no one else will. Ken, as I understand it, right now we sort of have a very large bright line here in which a prison can't have a contract and the employee of the county. Is that correct?
Bright line, it's a bright line rule.
I think we've got an employee that has a contract. assessment that we've been, they're in violation of that for years. What's the purpose for postponement?
I would just like further time to digest what's before us.
Can't be, do you think this makes this a better ordinance, this language you're adding, or are we trying to do something we...
I think it makes it a different ordinance.
Not necessarily better.
Forgive me, I mean, it's different, and it certainly provides greater flexibility if that's where the board wants to go.
Is this more in line with other counties, their ordinance, or is that all ordinance more?
I haven't researched that, and if the board would like me to take a look at other jurisdictions to see if they have similar sorts of language, I'd be happy to. And forgive me for not having done that.
Just for me, if you might, one of my concerns, I guess, would have been, and as I was looking into this, I asked a lot of questions. If we have an employee that offers a service or a product the counties wish interest to engage in a contract with at this point in time, even if they had a better product for a lesser dollar or a low bidder, we wouldn't be allowed to use that, would we?
That's correct. Which was one of the concerns raised to me specifically.
That's a definite. I think that the five items that you have crafted are pretty clear. I don't know how much more there is to digest, really, something like this. It seems pretty clear. I think sometimes we spend too much time on it to see what others are doing. That doesn't always, you know, we talked about that the other day with an issue. It seems pretty clear.
Are they in a rush, too? I mean, does he interfere in the lady 2 weeks with anything? I mean,
it's... Oh, well, that's it. I mean, we've just been about 2.5 to 3 months now, and it kind of, I guess, I wonder why here at 5:45 on the night of the public hearing we've not digested it. And it, you know, it takes task staff time to go back through it, and just to me, a waste of time. It's certainly up to this board.
I guess we had a work session discussion on this. And we voted on to send it to a public hearing. We've had two public hearings already.
We had, yes, sir.
We have a motion and a second on the floor. If there's no further discussion about the motion to postpone, what day was that, Brian?
2 weeks, March 15th.
And to postpone until March 15th. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-2. So this is postponed decisions on March 15th. Item number 4, I believe, is proposed amendments to the alcohol ordinance.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the next item is a second and final public hearing with respect to Sunday sales. As the board is aware, on next Tuesday, the voters of the county will vote with respect to whether to authorize the Sunday sale of packaged alcohol in Forsyth County. This ordinance modification will allow that if it is approved by the Board of Commissioners. The two sections, sections 2.5, hours of sale, and section 3.5, hours of sale, are set forth. It would allow the sale of packaged beer and wine between the hours of 12:30 p.m. and 11:30 p.m. on Sundays, and the sale of distilled spirits by the package between the hours of 12:30 p.m. and 11:30 p.m. on Sundays. If this ordinance is approved tonight, the earliest date it could be effective, assuming a successful referendum on Tuesday, would be March 18th of 2012. If in fact the referendum is unsuccessful, this ordinance will automatically be rendered due. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Sir.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone here this evening wishing to speak in favor of this alcohol amendment? Is there anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to this amendment? If not, do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Item number 5 is a second reading of the proposed amendment to the Forsyth County Parks and Recreation Ordinance. No?
We need to take action.
Oh, we need to vote on previous. Do I hear a motion on item number four regarding the alcohol ordinance?
I make a motion, Mr. Chairman, that we approve the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County alcohol ordinance, specifically to authorize Sunday sale of packaged alcohol upon successful March 6, 2012 referendum.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion on this item, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Now we are to item five.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item five is a second public reading with respect to proposed modification of Forsyth County Ordinance Number 102, which is the Forsyth County Park and Recreation Ordinance. This is actually, I think, the third public hearing we've had, but we did substantively modify it into the form that it is this evening. This modification to the code, quite frankly, works to send more authority and power to the Park and Recreation Board with respect to the issuance, promulgation, and enforcement of park and recreation policies, rules, and procedures. First of all, it provides that enforcement can be either with the Forsyth County manager, his designee, or authorized Forsyth County Park and Recreation employees, for instance, the Forsyth County Park and Recreation Director, which is where I know that there was some interest in making sure that was in fact the case. It further provides that the Park and Rec Board is established as the entity to recommend policies and procedures regarding access to recreational facilities, fields, indoor outdoor equipment, programming, park safety, and other issues. It also sets forth a protocol that the Park and Rec Board will deliver proposals for procedure modifications to the board. The board can either take an up or down vote to approve them and ratify them, or send them back with instructions, at which point the Park and Recreation Board can either change in light of the instruction, or can simply say they're happy with what they sent us the first time and send it back. At that point, we either have to say yes or no, but not amend. And that would be the way the new policies would work. Permits with respect to field uses, etc., would stay firmly vested in the Park and Recreation Department pursuant to Park and Recreation policies. I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, that later in the agenda, if you adopt this evening, then you will be faced with also having to ratify a book of Park and Recreation Board policies, which we have assembled for you in order for them to be effective tomorrow. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item, which passes unanimously. Is there anyone here this evening wishing to speak in favor of the proposed amendments to the recreation ordinance? Don't all speak up at once. Is there anyone here who would like to speak in opposition to it? Hearing none, Chair would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. What is the pleasure of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion we approve the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Park and Recreation Ordinance as presented by County Attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item number six, request by Corbin Woods.
AZ120004. This is an amendment to zoning conditions located in Commission District Number 5. The public hearing is for Corbin Woods regarding the deletion of conditions number 20 and 22 placed on zoning application 3395. Those conditions as currently worded are shown on your screen. The property is located on Trammell Road, approximately 250 feet south of the intersection with Benefield Road, and was zoned Res 3 by the Board of Commissioners on July 19, 2007.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone Wishing to speak in favor of this zoning condition change.
Good evening, my name is Corbin Woods. I'm here asking for your consideration of removal of these two zoning conditions from the zoning 3395. Specifically, to remove the pool and the associated location of the pool. And our rationale for it is in the neighborhood of this many homes. It's not economically feasible for the HOA long-term lifecycle of the community to have it. And we don't want to change anything else, nothing else with regards to any number of units or square footage or anything like that. Just merely to match up with the market with that size community that has developed. I'd like to reserve the balance of any time I have for any questions you may have or anybody else.
Mr. Woods, how many homes will you be building in this community?
At this point, the maximum that are allowed there are 27.
What's your plan? Do you plan to start this anytime? Is this just a long-term investment?
More of a longer term, based on how the market's going. Unfortunately, there have been some signs of the market picking up somewhat, but it would be, I couldn't commit to a time right now.
And I've got just a question.
Yes, sir.
I think you and I have already spoken, but wherever, on the piece of property or lot where the tennis courts and swimming pool were going to go, it is not your intention, nor does this capture any right to build houses or other living units on that land?
No, sir, it's not. This property has an open space requirement within the zoning conditions, which any conceptual layouts we've done, it meets and exceeds it. So we have no intention to capture anything when it's there.
Okay. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this? If not, do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
I move, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the item. And that passes unanimously. This is District 5. And I would like to make a motion that we adopt the deletion of zoning conditions 20 and 22 as requested.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? If not, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Item number 7 has been postponed until March 15th, which I believe takes us to old business. Number 1A, MedCam.
Yes, old business 1A, zoning application 3584, MedCam Inc. Located in Commission District Number 3, the request is to rezone from M1 and A1 to M1 on 9.179 acres for the expansion and construction of an existing business in 153,084 square feet of total building space with 157 parking spaces. The applicant is also requesting the following variances: one, elimination of rear yard setback 75 feet. 2, elimination of rear yard buffer of 60 feet. 3, to reduce the side yard setback to 40 feet. Excuse me, reduce the side yard setback of 40 feet to allow a 35 foot setback. To reduce the side yard buffer 35 feet to allow a 25 foot buffer on the west side. These are in reference to UDC Chapter 14-1.3, Table 14.2.
Mr. Brown, he's got a couple of changes he's working on right now. You want to like to put the new ones up, or
regarding conditions,
get you a copy to read as well, and then do that. We'll take it.
Okay. I will finish the generic component of my introduction, and we'll know that the conditions are soon to be on the screen. The Planning Commission recommended approval of rezoning from A1 and M1 to M1 with conditions. Current version of those conditions will soon be on the screen. And the public hearing was held on January 24th, 2012. Thank you.
Do you have the new conditions on the screen now? Okay.
I
excuse me, could you focus that just a little better, please? Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I realize this is a last-minute introduction. If you'd like us to make copies of that, I'm glad to make copies and display it. It's entirely up to you.
Is there a page two?
Yes, a page two.
Are all parties in agreement to the agreement?
Yes.
You are?
Yes, sir.
District 3 Commissioner. Suggestion for it, perhaps?
Has anybody here on the board had a chance to look at this property besides me?
I've looked at lots of maps and aerials and deeds, but I haven't gone out there.
I'll just say this before I make a motion on it. Both sides. We're in pretty far distance apart when this all came about. I got to give them thanks for working as hard as they have. Voluntarily postponed, and they had to really come in the middle on this one. I was perplexed as well with some of the things that were going on and the conditions they were asking for. However, now that they've all come to agreements, and they're happy, then I'm happy. I make a motion to approve the zoning changes for the ZA 3584 M1, from A1 to the M1, with the variances for the following, and I might agree again, just move off what Mr. Brown read to us, and approve them as also displayed on the screen.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion about this motion? Please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you. Old business item number two, is a discussion of the town hall meeting. It's the previous description from March 20. And I believe that Smart Growth has asked for a new date.
Mr. Chairman, that is correct. They have a significant interest in this particular project, and they have requested the meeting be rescheduled. And they have recommended a date of April 26th.
And so, Councilor, if we decide and vote to move to April 26th, that is how we will proceed from here, is that correct?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
Do I hear a motion from the board?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
We have time on that.
It was originally scheduled for 7 o'clock. I suspect that would probably be the same time if this board agrees to that time.
Please. 7 o'clock?
That would be great. 7 o'clock's a great time for the hearing.
Thank you.
And I assume it's going to be held here in this room.
Where is the next one?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Plan. Okay, we have a motion and did we get a second?
Yes.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. We're to new business, One, adoption of a resolution ratifying parks and recreation policies.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. This is the follow-up to the ordinance modifications that the board just approved with respect to the Forsyth County Park and Rec ordinance. That ordinance, as mentioned, anticipates that the Board of Commissioners will ratify all existing park and rec procedures. Well, I hope that all of you at your podium have a three-ring notebook that contains all of the park and rec procedures. And Mr. Kinsey is here, and we have worked with his office to secure all of these for the purposes of your ratification. Now, obviously, this is a two-inch thick book, and I must tell you that I do need to read every one of these. I'm just kidding, that was a joke. I will not read all of these. There are actually A through E are the various policies, procedures, rules, and regulations. A is the athletic division, B pertains to facility and pavilion rentals, C is the outdoor division, D is the recreation division, and E is the lake division. Mr. Chairman, for purposes of this evening, this is one of those instances where I'm going to have to ask you to take the word of myself and Mr. Kinsey that this is the Park and Rec policies, rules, and procedures that currently govern how the Park and Recreation Board and Department operate. Mr. Kinsey, could you add anything to that just to give the board further confidence of what they're doing?
We have read through this, and the Parks and Recreation Board have received this, so we all feel comfortable with this.
And you feel that you are already operating according to what is in here? There isn't anything other than the adoption of this new or unusual coming down the pike otherwise, is that true?
Correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, in light of that, it's up to the board's pleasure, of course, but my recommendation would be that you adopt the resolution in your agenda packet, which does, in fact, ratify this booklet, so these can be enforced effective tomorrow.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion from the board? If not, please vote on the motion. And that item passes unanimously. Item number two, placement of the city county water intergovernmental agreement on the April 5th public hearing calendar. County attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is simply a matter that was not passed unanimously at the work session. It was passed by a 4-1 vote, and therefore, per our rules, the Board of Commissioners needs to basically take this motion again during a regular meeting. And that is the reason it is on this evening. This pertains to the placement on the April 5th public hearing calendar, which is again pursuant to our rules because the board made a motion to do so. And it pertains to an intergovernmental agreement. So there does need to be a motion and vote, Mr. Chairman.
And is there a public hearing associated with this?
There is. If the board votes to go forward with the public hearing on April 5th, I will run a legal ad. And on April 5th, I will have an IGA prepared for you that will do what I believe the board was endeavoring to do at the work session. You have to have something to vote on that evening.
Betty, thank you. Chair would entertain a motion on this item.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to place the city-county water intergovernmental agreement on the April 5th, 2012 public hearing calendar.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion about this item? If not, please vote on the motion. That motion passes unanimously. Item number three, approval to move forward with public hearings for the UDC text amendment to Chapter 16.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, similar to the last item, this is an item that was discussed at work session. It was not a unanimous vote, it was a 4-1 vote. If this moves forward, the next step would be to take this to a public hearing at the Planning Commission. A real short summary of the product before you is that we limit the size of accessory structures in residential zoning districts. We have had two recent examples of people who have used hallways to connect accessory structures to their primary structure to avoid this limitation. And the staff was asked last year to draft a proposal to address that. The proposal before you would do that by setting a maximum hall length of 16 feet.
Thank you, Tom. Just flipping through some pages here.
This is just a quick move on with public hearing, Mr. Chairman.
I'd like to, the chairman's look is to reiterate to this board that since Forsyth County was founded in 1831, we've had two instances of someone connecting a structure with a hallway, and that this conservative board in the second most conservative county in the nation has spent time and money, staff resources, attorney time, and now public hearing time on something that has happened twice since 1831. Yet we can't seem to bring forward any UDC changes that will make our county more business friendly, make it easier for businesses to come, streamline the process, shorten the permitting time, shorten the rezoning time, reduce impact fees. We've done nothing while every county around us has been hard at work to make their county more business friendly, yet we sit here and worry about the length of hallways. And I would hope that you've had time to think about this and would agree that it's a total waste of time and money.
And yet we're growing faster.
I wouldn't say we were, Mr. Ball.
Well, the others do.
Or at the bare minimum, when it comes to public hearings, pay attention to see after we set it, because you need more time to review it.
I guess the public needs to ask us when we're going to do something to correct this, some of the other issues in our UDC that can actually be a benefit to the community.
Certainly, I've been here often enough for them to have said so.
Well, since 1831, we've had two complaints on this, and I'm glad we're making sure it's
done. I think you have to go back to when we first had zoning package. Since 1831, and they had a big lots of garden.
When did zoning come into effect, Mr. Anderson?
We had to ask Mr. Brown, I think. In the 70s.
In the 70s, this...
Well, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
So 50 years. I would say that we need to hurry up and move it through then.
Well, just make the state correct if you can make it.
The county was founded in 1831. We've had two issues since the county was founded. That is an accurate statement. Since zoning was enacted in the early 70s, some 50 years ago, we've had two issues, and we need to worry about this. Yet we rate making the county user-friendly. Some of us didn't even vote on it, mind you, about the priorities of some of these projects. Some didn't even vote, and they don't know, and we can't seem to bring that issue forward. That's what bothers me. We spend more time on this limiting people's rights than we do on trying to make our county more user-friendly. That's my point.
Who are users of the county?
That would be the citizens. That would be people that want to bring businesses here, that want to bring jobs and equipment that has high lower taxes on it, that reduces the burden on the citizens so that we can continue to expand libraries and build park and rec, and it's not putting the burden on our homes. Those are the users.
2 years for that reason.
I've heard good things. I picked up a newspaper today that said pretty good things about the county.
Building permits are wonderful, but every house that's built under $350,000 costs us money. I'm talking about bringing businesses and jobs to this county. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about building permits.
Building houses bring jobs and also bring businesses.
Mr. Anderson, you can try to talk about all you want. The fact of the matter is, we're not making this county more user-friendly. We have not done anything to encourage businesses to come here. I've got an email from a business that says he wished he wouldn't come here. They were too bureaucratic. It takes too long. Do you know that? You ran on that in your platform.
Well, we're working on changing things. It takes time. I found that out. It does. It moves slow, but we are changing.
It does when people don't vote on things, when people don't try to push it forward. But yet, we do need to get this hallway issue taken care of. It's a critical issue. the length of a hall. It's important to somebody. Two people since 1831.
How many people should live this?
I'm just, two people since 1831. Our sin zoning came into effect. This hard to get the hallway situation regulated.
Well,
people try to address every citizen's concern.
Except for the 175 to 180,000 citizens of the water contract of the hallway. You want to postpone the water. I get your priorities. I see it. That's good.
Are you good to stick to the subject right now? It's about this hallway. You know, because you think certain other things are important doesn't mean what other people think is not important.
I didn't say that other things were important. What I'm saying is this board's taken no proactive approach. And some didn't even think enough of some of the issues that we had before us, even though they didn't even take the time to rate them so that we would know how to prioritize them. That's what I'm saying. We continue to push it down to the bottom while the length of the hallway comes to the top. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not saying it's not important. I'm just saying that I think that our citizens would appreciate us doing what we could to bring businesses here, not further restrict property rights and worry about the length of a hallway or the configuration of somebody's home.
I think Mr. Brown and staff are working diligently on all these things. His staff is small.
He's doing a great job.
He's got a whole laundry list of things to change.
They're doing a great job. Our staff is small. And that's exactly the reason I wonder why we're wasting your time with this kind of nonsense.
Since somebody cared about it, so it was just a nonsense.
I would like to, I spoke to you earlier today about this. The real issue, as I understand it, was a situation where somebody built an accessory building after they had their primary building. And I don't want to get into all the reasons it happened, but then after they built that accessory building or secondary building, possibly inappropriately, they connected it with a hallway or a breezeway and were able, under the existing UDC, to call that a single unit, I guess, or single dwelling. I don't think this captures that actual phenomenon of a person who comes in and has a primary building and then a secondary building of some kind and then connects the two. If it does capture that, it also seems like it probably might prohibit somebody from doing a building like this that's designed or built all at once. And I would like to know if it might be possible to change some of the wording here so that it only affects situations where there's a primary building, a secondary building gets built, and then it's attempted to be connected by a longer than 16-foot breezeway or hallway.
I would concur with that. If somebody brings in a set of original plans and they're showing a separate garage building all together at the same time they're submitting their plans, and they have a breezeway that has to connect the two, obviously then they need to use over 16 feet, and I think that should be acceptable. But in the case of trying to cheat the system, adding a secondary building onto the property where it doesn't belong and then called as one unit by after the fact that in the hallway, I would agree that probably shouldn't take place.
Yes, I think I agree with that one. I just heard the if all the improvements made on a property are submitted under one permit and built at the same time, the intent of this was not to try to apply the 16-foot limitation to that product. Now that can be viewed as a positive or a negative, and I'm not sure what our stance is on that, but. What it doesn't try to do is restrict what could be a very unique or one of a kind type of architectural layout that someone might propose on the property. Now, at the same time, if someone really is looking to essentially have an accessory structure and just connect with a hallway, build it at the same time as the primary residence. I don't see this giving me the ability to call that an accessory building and deny that permit. But as the chairman pointed out, maybe we could continue to refine the wording if this moves forward to make sure there aren't that type of question and how it will be applied.
Thank you.
Which brings me to the concept of if this moves forward, do we need, if we would like the words to be changed to reflect something similar to what I was discussing, do we just direct Tom to do that now, or do we vote to do this and then change it later?
I would, and I'd like to hear input from our legal staff as well, if you could, if we vote to change it later, and I have a first public hearing and I advertise and make a document available, and then we significantly change that document, very likely could require us to have an additional public hearing later. So if you have what you feel is some fairly specific direction for me, I would like to hear it tonight before I can try to incorporate it into the document and we get this done in two hearings and not have it turn into three hearings.
I agree with that. That's accurate.
You got some special wording you want?
I don't have the special wording other than to just say the situation that I was hoping to hit was one that prevents a secondary building from being linked to a primary building or any other two buildings by a hallway longer than 16 feet or longer than 16 feet.
And I think are we trying also to clarify that when the entire product comes in at once under one set of plans, we are not going to view that as an accessory building when it's all connected.
Correct.
Yeah, and somehow you may want to reference back to when it's built at the same time, plans coming at the same time, the built with same materials and same architectural design, and one building complements the other one. For instance, some folks put really big houses and they only put two-car garage in it. We only want to set out to side a four-car garage, but then it all matches perfectly. And they may need a 30 or 35-foot walk that may be suspended or not.
Is that directive enough, Tom?
I think I can come back with something and hit the public hearing stage.
Mr. Chairman, I think too at the work session, these same exact concerns were articulated. So I think between reviewing the work session comments and then the comment tonight, we're going to be able to figure something out.
Yeah, so I'd like, is there a motion from the board about putting this on as a public hearing?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to table this item. Make a motion to table it.
Do I hear a second? I think that motion fails for lack of a second.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion we move forward to public hearing with the extra statements and conditions we talked to Tom about.
Sir.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the issue. And that passes 4-1. Which carries us to administrative hearings. No, not yet.
Four more, yes.
These will be clear. Brief on the consent agenda. The item for here. I think this goes to the county attorney.
Mr. Chairman, it does. I'll start with the first one, which I believe was the removal of the Sony EMC right-of-way easement from the consent agenda by motion and second. Mr. Chairman, this is just an item that we've got two of these actually that my office is working on right now, and I would request the board move to place this on the next work session agenda to give me some time to negotiate with Sony.
What day is that, Council?
Ms. Bush. March 6th.
So moved. March 6th, work session.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the issue. And that passes unanimously. Item number five.
Mr. Chairman, is this the advanced ambulance matter?
Yes,
sir. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is a matter that was removed off the consent agenda as well. It had been previously approved at a work session, I believe, which is why it went to the consent agenda. Just an issue has been raised with respect to some of the corporate formalities followed with respect to the execution of the document by Advanced Ambulance. I would like to work with purchasing, the purchasing director, to make sure that the appropriate seal is applied to the contract, and a few other things, just to make sure that there is the authority to execute it. If the board wants to take action this evening, I'm certainly fine with that based upon the consent agenda placement. I would just ask the motion to approve be caveated by the fact that execution by the chairman is not authorized until the county attorney working with the director of purchasing is comfortable that the individual signing on behalf of Advanced Ambulance has the authority to do so.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item. And that passes unanimously. Number six.
Mr. Chairman, item number six, I believe, pertains to a potential modification of the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. This is an item only for discussion. The issue raised was whether or not we ought to take a look at the alcohol code, particularly with respect to some disqualifying events. Our alcohol code is fairly tough. And one of the things it provides is that it is an automatic disqualifying event if an individual has an offense on the record that is considered a crime of moral turpitude. There are various case law interpretations of that, but there is at least enough case law to suggest that even a bad check offense can be considered a crime of moral turpitude. There is language to the contrary as well, to be candid. But I think there is some concern that that being a permanent disqualifying event forever seems a little harsh and perhaps a little too strong. So the thought was is to perhaps give me direction, go ahead and change the code, bring back some amendments that would remove that language or at least tone it down, and to do that on an expedited basis, run the two public hearings back to back with a minimum of 15 days to frame. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Sir.
I just have one question. You know, it's sometimes hard to do two things. Number one is anticipate everything that might happen. And number two, when you're reading words, which as you're reading them, kind of dry, it's doubly hard sometimes. And yet we've changed sort of this general area of the alcohol ordinance for another situation real recently.
We did, that's correct.
Do you think we can include in our discussion, you know, I don't want to get into the exhaustive list of all things that might happen, but upon reflection, some of these sort of seem like they might have been prevented from being there in the first place if we had been able to get around some of these limitations.
Chairman, it's a fair question. The ordinance, the alcohol code particularly, has changed, quite frankly, in a way that the county has also changed over time, and the way the county views alcohol and alcohol consumption. I don't think it's terribly surprising that we're having to just basically catch up with where the county has gone as it's increased in population, et cetera. But you're right, there are some rules now in the code that perhaps make less sense than they did years and years and years and years ago when it was first adopted. So I can't dispute you on that. We're trying to adopt modifications as quickly as these issues come before, but I'll agree with you. We just did this, I think, in that situation as a prohibition. If you had ever had a license denied in another jurisdiction, you were prohibited here for, I think, 5 years. And similarly, I believe there was a concern that that seemed a little harsh. Mm-hmm. It was the same sort of situation.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Second, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Now I think we're at the administrative hearing. And I'd just like everyone to know that this is not a public hearing. The hearings are not open for the general public to speak, but are hearings in which we'll hear from the people who were actually involved in the incident. The first one is an administrative hearing in reference to violations of the Forsyth alcohol ordinance for a Big Apple venture.
Yes, thank you. Dig Apple Ventures LLC doing business as Granny's. This is located in Commission District Number 4, and is an administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Dig Apple Ventures LLC.